Hey guys, this is Faye from Feisworld Media. In this video, I want to share my experience of working with Seth Godin on my latest documentary called Feisworld, which is now available for streaming on Amazon Prime, on Vimeo On Demand.
You can get everything in life you want if you'll just help enough other people get what they want. And inherent in that is a little bit of give and then you get. But what I discovered about the connection economy and the culture we were living in is you didn't have to do the second part. If you could just figure out how to give, the culture itself showed up in a way that let you do it more.
I'll include some of the links below. Definitely check them out and let me know of your feedback. And Seth Godin is in episode 4 with Dory Clark, and the name of the episode is called Pay Forward.
Hey guys, and I'm editing this now towards the end of 2020. The video that you're watching now was recorded a little bit earlier, and I have something even more exciting to share because my master artist mom from the Forbidden City of Beijing, China, is living with me in my new house, and she has just very recently completed this astonishing, I don't know, just incredible portrait of Seth Godin, as you can see behind me, right here in my office. And the Chinese title means take off, and Go is the book that you're going to be seeing in this video in a second. And Seth always refers to, I don't know, us, his students, as the ravens. We decided to put this little chubby cute raven on his shoulder. I told Seth it represents me and all his students, and he's the best teacher we could ever ask for. So thanks for watching. Now back to the video.
I want to talk about my, I think, unique experience. Maybe it isn't so unique. I don't know. I just haven't really seen on YouTube with so many reflection videos of people talking about what it's like to really work with him, to be in the same room with him, rather very finished products of famous people, lots of views, and you are seeing really what's been put together as opposed to behind the scenes content. When I reach out to Seth, he was, to me, surprisingly humble. He replied, and I remember trying to arrange for the shoot to happen and talking about where to park. Could I be put in touch with an assistant of yours? Guess what he said? Faye, it's just me. It's just me. I realize that he really is a one-man show. Many people don't realize he has a lot of kind of freedom and flexibility in his life. He doesn't jam-pack his calendar. In fact, he always leaves enough room for him to kind of pick and choose the project that he wants to work on. So on the day of the shoot, I knew something immediately that he's gonna not only be on time, he's gonna be early. So for us, as part of the production team, you know, when you rent a place, there's so much that needs to be done and always feels a little last minute. For example, we did something before every sit down interview with these guests on my documentary, which is that I'm going to do a pre-interview. That means I'm standing in front of the camera and my director, my producer are asking me questions and recording my feelings and anxieties and thoughts right before the interview. While they're doing that, I noticed for other guests, almost all of them showed up on the dot, like perfectly on time. But somehow part of me knew that Seth is gonna show up 15 minutes before, and of course he did. As soon as I saw him come in, he waved, he sat down, and I finished my recording. Then I met him in the cafe, so kind of in the lobby of the hotel. And so as we're walking to the room where we're going to conduct the shoot, you know, of course we set everything up the day before, it was all ready. During my walk, he quickly assessed who I was. Okay, I was part of LTMBA, I was part of the marketing seminar, so he knows that I'm familiar with him. But he didn't know how long I had been following his work. It was way before LTMBA. In fact, I started reading his book back in college, I believe it was junior year, and it was super comforting for me as an immigrant college student. LTMBA just kind of brought me even closer to his work, and I built a community and a network because of that. So he asked me what I did. I said, I'm a creative entrepreneur. I work for individual as well as companies. And I'll never forget that he responded back with, okay, which one do you like better? I said, individuals. And he said, but they don't pay very well, right? And I said, that's also true. So I combined that line of work with the companies I work for. Fast forward a year and a half, most of my clients are individuals I love working with. So once he sat down, he was very professional. He's seen this type of environment so many times. And he, of course, remembered to bring his books because as we're traveling, as much as I want to bring my 20 of Seth Godin's books, it would just be obviously impractical and too heavy to carry around. So he brought 5-6 of his books, and I still remember which ones there were. One of my favorite is What to Do When It's Your Turn, and It's Always Your Turn. And he brought Lynchpin, my other favorite, Tribe. Oh my God, I love Tribe. By the time we sat down, the interview so happened that with the camera we had, which was a Canon C200 cinematic camera, I was told by my director, get closer and closer to Seth. I definitely felt pressured and, a little nervous as I was sitting down so close to him in a way I never felt before, because I already met Seth in person a couple of times before this, but it was in a group setting where he was on the stage and talking to us, which he wasn't really talking to me one-on-one. I was also nervous because I've seen so many interviews with Seth where he has his go-to, he knows what he's talking about. I figure with someone like myself, who he doesn't know very well or really know our cause or our theory or whatever we're trying to do for the film, I thought he would be more reserved and not let out as much. So the few moments that really resonated with me are, I wanted to share, I wanted to tell him the truth of why his work impacted me so much. When I was a sophomore, junior in college, I had a lot of anxiety. I don't think it was unusual for someone, my age at the time, 19, 20 years old, but especially as an Asian immigrant, as an Asian female immigrant coming from China, I definitely felt the urge or the desire to, or the question that I had was, am I making a positive impact? Am I moving forward? Am I making progress? On top of that, I think when you're that age, you do have some self-sabotaging thoughts that you're so small, you're not good enough, all your peers are stronger, better, everything better than you are. So it was very challenging. I lost sleep over it. I lost some weight. I don't even remember what I had to go through. And following Seth Godin's writing made me realize that every time I read his work, I felt better. I felt better about myself, to be honest. I felt certain. I felt supported. I felt like I was gonna make it. It was really quite magical because I had never met him in person, never heard of him when I was growing up. He wasn't really the Jackie Chan martial arts figure. So it just distilled so much comfort in me. And hearing his voice, especially, if you like Seth Godin's work, you probably love the fact that he does narrate all of his books. And that is just irreplaceable. Being able to sit down with him during the interview, I just didn't really have the guts to tell him, not even in that extended story, but just to tell him and the impact he had in my life, that every time I felt like I wasn't gonna be okay, reading his book made me feel all right. Like, let's do this, I can make it. But instead, I shared another story, which was back in 2009, my dad was actively dying, basically. He had stage 3 esophageal cancer. I ended up leaving my job in the US to be in the hospital with him in China. And it was just so difficult mentally and physically. And it was even worse for my mom. So I bought several books. It was very little that I could do really at the hospital. I was very uncomfortable. So I ended up reading and writing so much during that period of time. I wish I could publish some of the work as well from then. It really came from my heart, everything I did. But my dad's condition didn't really allow him to actively having these productive conversations or loving conversations with me. It was kind of in very short bursts, 2-3 minutes at a time at best. So I ended up purchasing books in Chinese, books I've read before, including Freakonomics, and I got The Purple Cow in China. I ended up reading Purple Cow to my dad, who was, in his hospital bed. And we ended up having these conversations we never had before. And there's something about the way Seth writes that are very relatable and non-intimidating, without words that are going to confuse people for the most part, and very storified. So it was super cool. I told Seth during our interview that I started to have conversations that I never had with my dad because we didn't really have the best of the relationships. And he was really touched. I remember him leaning in even more, and I saw just emotions. I didn't see tears coming down his face, but I saw it just that emotions, like a couple of tears like circling in his eyes. And he was really touched by the story. And for that, I'm really grateful that I was able to share it, because part of me felt like, does he need to hear this? Does he really care? But I wanted him to know that's the level of impact it had on my life. And that's why I'll never forget. Another moment that I really loved about our interview was me realizing and mentioning the fact that after listening to a Kimball, going to a marketing seminar and all these groups and gatherings, even in-person gatherings with his cohorts and people he has taught, was that the diversity is just kind of incredible. I've belonged to a lot of masterminds, groups of people that I've interacted with, not just here in Boston, but worldwide and in Asia, other parts of the US. And I noticed that oftentimes in the room, when I'm hoping for there to be more people, not necessarily like me, but I would love to meet people from around the world, people of different backgrounds, ethnicities, skin colors. I just love that type of environment. But not until I met Seth, I realized that that's exactly what's happening. So I asked him, you know, how come there's such diversity? You know, while he is clearly Caucasian of Jewish descent and he lives in New York, also for his podcast called Akimbo, at the end of each episode, he invites people to drop him, send him messages. And to be honest, guys, like, there are questions that had such heavy accent that I almost didn't understand. But then Seth will be responding and clarifying that he included those audios on his podcast. Every accent you can imagine. And he was so proud of that. I could tell how happy that question made him. And he said, Faye, you know, usually in a gathering, I am the one with the accent. And he asked me, do you know what I mean by that? I so regret for not asking him because I feel like I sort of knew what he meant of him being in a very diverse group. And oftentimes he probably is the only guy with a New York accent. The final touch of the spiel, I guess, is feeling pretty nervous. And there was a shorter interview, even though it was, I think it was about 45 minutes. I tried to keep him there as long as I could. And on his way out, I decided to kind of bring him out of the hotel. It's a very Chinese way, which I greet him when he comes in and also when he leaves. And he said, this is me. And he said, you know what, Faye, that was, you did a really good job. You're good at that. And he also asked me, did I do okay? Was that okay? Because I know this is important to you. And I was just so touched that he said that to me. As we conclude each and every one of these interviews for our documentary, I offered to hug all my clients. We'll both get up and hug. And I just so wasn't sure whether I could hug Seth Godin or not. I didn't want him to feel offended. I wanted to ask for his permission first, which I did. So I said, Seth, can I hug you? And he literally looked at me. He's like, go for it. I just remember telling this story and then everybody laughed. I think people from my production team also giggled quite a few times. Anyway, I did end up hugging Seth and I'm glad that after all these years, my goodness, like 13, 14 years of reading every word, every book he's ever written, including a massive one that I purchased at the end of an event. And it's just an incredible journey. So I think we all have our heroes and sometimes our heroes would disappoint us. I was really nervous to meet him. I know that, you know, Seth may not be the most warm and fuzzy person I'll ever meet, but I'm glad that I gathered the courage to do that and to be able to learn more from him in person. And I hope you will meet your heroes as well. And that doesn't really change the trajectory of the path that you're on. And I want to make sure you know this, that you are the one who is special. You are the one who's going to change the world or change your community. And sometimes you don't know that. And that's why it's so hard to be a creative entrepreneur. But know that I'm rooting for you from over here, wherever you are. I'm glad you're doing this work. And I really appreciate you for doing that. Until the next video, and I hope to see you then. Take care.